Welcome to this episode of Now That's Something Good, the podcast where we explore the extraordinary in the everyday ordinary. Now here's your host, Sarah Good.
Hey friends, welcome back to the show. Hope you guys are doing well. I hope you had a great holiday and are ready to just start a brand new year. Will and I are very excited to be coming back to you guys with podcasts. We've had to take a little break in there where we had Corona. We had some family things going on and with the holidays, but we are very excited to be back at it and bringing you stories and conversations on a regular basis. If you don't remember, because it's been a little bit, we release a brand new episode of Now That's Something Good every single Wednesday, and we've got an incredible January lined up for you. We spent some of our holiday break recording stories, and I cannot wait for you to hear this. So, inquiring minds want to know. Let's talk about goal setting in a new year for just a moment. Are you one of those people that enjoy finding a word for the year, a focus for the year, setting new goals? Or are you just kind of like, it's another year, I'm just going to keep going? There's no right or wrong answer, but Will and I would love to know. Will and I are those people that do take a little bit of time to kind of, at the end of one year, the beginning of a new year, take time to reflect back on what's happened over the last year and kind of take some time to look forward. So, over the next few weeks, we're going to have conversations that really just kind of take a look at that. And they're really coming at it in a very unique way. So don't worry if you're like, I don't really want to hear any more about goal setting, or I don't want to hear any more about new resolutions or all that. That's okay. Hang with us. I think you're still going to enjoy these conversations. Actually, right now where I'm recording this intro, Will and I are on vacation. We started a new habit and a new practice a few years ago where every January, right at the beginning of the year, we sneak away, just the two of us, to really just one, relax, reset, and rest, and also just spend some time really looking back at the past year and looking forward to what's ahead. It's been a really natural rhythm that kind of works in our life and place. And so we're going to be recording an episode while we're here on vacation for you guys that will be out next week. I can't wait for you to hear it. We're going to share some fun stories. Unfortunately, and fortunately for you, we've already had a few stories happen to us here on our trip that we can't wait to share with you. And we're going to talk just a little bit about our process and how we kind of look at New Year's and past years and all that fun stuff. But today, I'm really excited for you to hear this conversation with Anna Real. Now, here's something you need to know about Anna Real. Her last name might be Real, and my last name might be Good, but we used to, a few years back, had the same last name, McConaughey. Yes, Anna is my sister. We both married, so we have different last names now, but she is incredible and has a very kind of different way at coming out, at setting goals and intentions and looking at a brand new year, and I think it's going to be a huge benefit to you. We talk about all kinds of things. We talk about what it was like growing up together. We share some stories about that and our childhood. And then we talk about personalities and just all of these different things. And I think you're really going to enjoy this conversation. So that was a very long intro, but we've missed you guys and we had a lot to catch up on. So go grab a cup of coffee, get a cup of tea, whatever your beverage of choice is. We're not discriminatory here. Whatever you want to drink, come sit, hang out with us and lean into this conversation. Hey friends, welcome back to Now That's Something Good. I am really excited today to have a very special guest who's actually my sister, Anna, here with me.
Hello.
Welcome, Anna. Thanks for being here. glad you could join us. Why don't you just starting off, tell us just a little bit about who you are, your family situation, all those things.
My name is Anna Real. I am a blogger and YouTuber and coach. I have a husband named Anthony Real.
Yes. That's pretty much, that works. That works.
That's me.
That's you. I love it. As I said, we are related. We don't, you know, people would never know anymore because we don't have the same last name. We were actually saying we have a brother too that I actually work with. And no one would ever know any of us are related because now we all have different last names. Mm-hmm. And Anna, who do you think you look like in our family?
I don't know. I feel like I look the most like Nathan.
I think I'm
a combination of mom and dad.
Yeah. We're going to have to post a picture now so you can see our family and you can tell us who you think. Because I think we all do look fairly different. Like some siblings you see and I think it's all like, oh, they clearly look like siblings. I do think you and Nathan look more like than like you and I look like. You have dark.
Especially when I shaved my head.
Yes. which actually I feel like we need to talk about. That's a great segue. We need to talk about. So Anna, you have, she's mentioned that she's a YouTuber and a blogger. You have a YouTube channel and mm-hmm. you posted, people can go find this, which I recommend that you do because it is great.
Oh,
so do you want to talk about shaving your head or what led to this whole endeavor?
Yeah, it was something that I'd wanted to try for a long time. And I realized the only thing holding me back was fear. I was just afraid, like, would people judge me? What if my head looks weird? And it's like, it's just hair. Like, it can grow back. And so I did it. I shaved my head. And it's funny, if you watch the video, you can see the fear in my eyes as I do the first shave. And I'm like, oh no, this is going to look really, really bad. But then I kept going and I was like, yay, I have a good shaped head. And it all worked out.
So I have several questions about this. Because you actually do, like, you... I do not think a lot of people can actually pull off the bald head look. You did great.
Thank you.
It looked really good. You have the, like I said, go watch the video. It was crazy because I think you actually told me you were doing this. If I remember right, you sent me a video or the picture. And when you sent it to me, Anna's shaving her head and I'm literally at the hairdresser getting more hair put in my head. I'm getting extensions and I'm like, this is just hilarious. She's trying to get rid of her hair and I'm trying to put more hair in, but it was great. That was a fun, what was your feedback on the shaving head? Like a lot of people, you got a lot of feedback on it, right?
Yeah. It seemed to inspire a lot of people too that had the same desire of like, I wanted to try this, but I was just too afraid. And
right. Well, at the end of the day, this hair, it grows back and mm-hmm.
And end up being my most viewed video. So,
okay, there you go. See, you never know. You never know what crazy thing might just, you just never know. Okay. So Anna, let's talk about this. So let's talk about your blog and all of these things. So you're kind of, tell people, what is your kind of tagline to your blog, to your, all the things Anna Real?
Yeah, my tagline is know yourself, grow yourself, because I believe a growing understanding of self is the key to personal growth and reaching your full potential. Because it's like, how can you be the best version of you if you don't even know who you are?
That's great. So where did all of this start? Like, when? I mean, there had to be some kind of starting place. Like, where did it all come from? When did you get that tagline? Just kind of give us the journey to the journey you are now on.
If you don't mind a little bit of a longer story,
stories here.
We're going to go back to high school.
Perfect. Perfect.
Because I feel like that's where some major things happened to spark my journey of learning more about who I am and my personality and learning about different personality theories. So in high school, I was starting to learn about introversion versus extroversion.
Okay.
But I had a lot of misconceptions. I felt like it was, like a skill to be developed. And so like, you know, people always praised extroversion and it's like, oh, you need to be more extroverted. And so when I started to learn that like, oh, introversion is like my personality, I felt like something was wrong with me, or like I was lesser than other people. Our world is just very built for extroverts, even the classroom, you know, and public speaking and even just in the classroom. And
okay, wait, take a real quick second though. So in case somebody's listening and doesn't know, I think introvert, extrovert is probably pretty common words that people would know, but just for clarity's sake, just tell people what you mean by that as you're telling your story, just so they really understand.
Yeah. So first I'm going to bust some myths about it because I feel like it's just very misunderstood. A lot of people think that extroversion it just always means like, oh, you're outgoing, you're super outgoing and you're super social and you like to party all the time. Yep. Introverts, you know, they're just quiet and shy. But that's actually not the case. Introverts can be outgoing and extroverts can be more quiet.
Yeah.
Extroverts can even have social anxiety. And so the outside behavior is kind of actually, that doesn't actually help you figure that out as much. So, it's more about where you get your energy from. So introverts, get more energy from their internal world. And so it's more about like where you get your energy from and how much you are focusing on your internal versus external world.
Okay. Okay.
Does that explain it well enough? It does. Or should I go into that, any more?
Well, why don't you tell more of your story and then we can come back and talk about that more if we need to, or explain what that looks like.
So I found this book called The Introvert Advantage, and it really changed my life. Like, as you can expect from the title, it's when I first started learning, like, oh, these are the strengths I have as an introvert. And I think, like, whenever you are really good at something, sometimes you don't realize it's a strength because it just comes naturally to you, and you don't realize, like, oh, other people aren't good at this. And
right. Absolutely.
And so that book helped me because I just felt like I was just missing something by being an introvert and not an extrovert, you know? Okay. And so I started to learn, like, oh, you know, these are the things that extroverts are generally better at, but, like, these are the things that I'm actually more naturally better at than they are. And so it just, like, opened my eyes that, you know, these two things, introversion versus extroversion, aren't, it's not like one's better or lesser than the other. Right. They're just different. They just have different sets of strengths and weaknesses. But then I started to feel like I still felt different from other introverts.
Okay.
And that's when I started coming across, like, different, like Myers-Briggs based online kinds of tests. And that's when I found out that I'm an INFJ.
Okay.
And it's actually kind of crazy that I was tested right, because a lot of online tests aren't super reliable, because it's just hard to, a lot of it is, you know, when you answer the questions, it's kind of up to interpretation. And I highly recommend, if you want to really find out your type, to either dive deep into it or just find an expert who knows about it and have them, like, there's people out there who do personality profiling sessions and,
Do you want to real quick, and again, we can come back and talk about this a little bit more because this is part of your coaching and some of your other things that you talk about, but what is the Myers-Briggs? Just so, again, if somebody doesn't know what that is, and when you say INFJ, they're like, what
does this mean?
No, it's okay. Why don't you just quickly tell that, and then you can keep going with your story, and we'll come back and hit on it more.
Yeah, so there's the MBTI, which stands for Myers-Briggs Type Indicator, and there's actually some other personality theories based on very similar things. They all come from Carl Jung's work.
Okay.
And
that's okay. So tell the letters. You said you're an I. So there's basically, like, I is introvert, but you could be an I or an E, right?
Yes.
So explain that.
Yeah, so Myers-Briggs has dichotomies, and so it's all about how, like, we each have different psychological preferences. Like, they use that word preference in Myers-Briggs, where it's like you have a preference for introversion versus extroversion.
Yeah, okay.
Intuition versus sensing.
Okay.
Thinking versus feeling, and perceiving versus judging.
Okay.
Myers-Briggs works in those dichotomies, and there's other 16 type systems as well that use cognitive functions that also, I don't want to get too much into it right now, but I just wanted to say that part because I'm technically not certified in MBTI, but I'm currently in an apprenticeship to learn another kind of, like, 16 type system.
Okay. Okay.
That's based off of cognitive functions. And
that's amazing. That's where you could dive super deep. And I'm sure Anna will give us some resources in a little bit where people can go back if they want to find out more. And we'll come back and talk about it, because personality tests, all those things are tools that can be really helpful in just personal development and personal growth, right?
Yes.
Okay. So you were telling your story. You found out, took the test, found out you're an INFJ. And then where?
Yeah. So that was another big moment in my life. And I remember I was reading the description and I just started crying because I had never felt more seen in my entire life. Like, I kind of felt like I was weird. And then I had, like, like, having this label was, like, kind of actually comforting. It's like, oh, there's other people out there like me.
That's huge.
And, like, the reason I had trouble finding very many people who kind of thought the same way that I did was because it was just, like, a smaller percentage of the population that had that personality type. So it just, like, made more sense. And
Yeah. Okay. That's
less
great.
Like a weirdo.
Well, you're not a weirdo, Anna, but I'm glad you felt less like one then. Okay. So then that kind of, what happened from there is you're learning this kind of spurred on.
Yeah. So I just kept studying it and learning about it. And I went to college for counseling, actually, because I love psychology and I love helping people. And that was originally my plan, to become a counselor. But during my time there, I had two professors really encourage me in my writing.
Okay.
Shout out to Doug Lay and Kent Sanders. So writing was something that I had put on the back burner. I have a lot of different hobbies. Like,
yeah,
our whole family does.
Yeah. Let's be honest.
Like, all the art and music. And I just felt like I wasn't a very good writer. So that's something that I had kind of let go.
Yeah.
But then those two professors really encouraged me. And then I had to start a blog for a writing for publication class with Professor Sanders. And I'm the kind of person, like, I'm either all in or not. So all or nothing. So I went all in. I was the nerd who, before the class even started, like the summer before, he told me that I was going to be needing to start a blog for the class. So I started researching everything, like how to start a blog, like how to build a brand. And
yeah.
I just went all in. I bought a website. I thought, like, might as well actually give this thing a real try.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so actually my first website was called Animotion.
Oh yeah. I forgot. Okay. Yeah. That's funny.
Yeah. And so then that evolved into now therealanna.com after I got married, because it's spelled R-E-E-L, like my last name.
We got to talk about this for a minute. Anna and I both fell into happy, coincidences are not the right word, but just happy situations with our last name.
Yes.
Because our given by birth last name is McConaughey. I don't know. And I probably have never
that would have been too hard to spell on a website.
It's 13 letters. I mean, literally. So like my name, you have a long middle name too. We both have short first names, but then our middle names are long. And then I think I literally have like 23 of the 27 letters in alphabet when it was Sarah Elizabeth, because there's a Z in Elizabeth McConaughey. It was like, how many more letters could you have? So we both went from 13 letter last names to 4 letter last names, where one letter is repeated. So you got real. And so you've done a playoff on that. I got good, which is now that's something good podcast is not just,
we like
a play
here
on the name. We do. It's really our mom's fault. I feel like we should just give her credit where
credit
is due.
Our mom is a writer. Our dad is a preacher. So they both are really good with words.
Yes. It was just by default that, you got more of the writing, like the punny, like that side. I probably got more of just the talk a lot part of all of it. I'm not as creative although I can be when I have to give messages, I can channel dad's inner, like, oh, what do you call that all of a sudden? Not the acrostics, but the, what's it called when the letters
run? Alliteration?
Like, alliteration. That's the word. All
there's
I can
a lot
think of was synonym. And I'm like, synonym is not the right word. Yes, a lot of alliteration.
He likes those alliterations.
Yes.
And mom, her children's books, I think a lot of them had alliterations as well.
So sorry, friends. It just comes out of us. What can we say? Anyway, okay. So you started the blog, got that started. It was Animotion. Now it's The Real Anna.
Yes.
And then that really kind of sparked, because I remember when you were starting all of that, and it just kind of sparked this whole journey it's a career.
I totally fell in love with it. And I remember I was praying about it, because I'm an all or nothing person. And I was like, this is going to be a lot of time if I'm actually trying to make money off of it. If I'm trying to, like, it was just taking up so much time. So I was like, I either need to let this like lower down to just a hobby and I can do it whenever, or continue to take it seriously. And I decided to just keep on going with it.
Yeah.
And so a few years later is when I started my YouTube channel.
Okay.
Because I was following someone named Brittany Bolin, and she's known for personality marketing. She does a lot of, she has a lot of good resources on video marketing. And she talks about how video is the quickest way for your customers to like, know, and trust you.
So great.
Versus when you read something and you can kind of hear the person's personality, but and you can't really see their face. Maybe there's a picture on their website, but like hearing our voice, like right now, you can hear more of their personality. Or
absolutely,
if you watch videos, like, I don't know if you've watched a lot of YouTubers and you feel like you know them, like your friends, even though they have no idea who you are.
My just, like, kids kind of in particular would think several people are their BFFs if they met them right now.
Yes.
I love it. Okay.
Yeah. So I started that because I knew that I was wanting to eventually, maybe create courses or lead into coaching, now I have started. And
perfect. I love it. So tell me, Anna, then what's the real heart? Like you said, your kind of tagline for, I hate to say tagline because I almost make it feels like it's a cliche and it's not. I mean, it's like a life phrase really that you live by. Know yourself, grow yourself. Let's come back and talk about like, why is it really so important? Why have you decided to do this work? Why would you say that people's life can really be so much better by continuing to know themselves more?
Yeah, so I have a big passion for it. Well, first of all, just my own personality. I just love psychology and personality theory and understanding how people's minds work. But aside from that, just with my own experience, like I remember that place in high school when I felt really down about myself and just didn't understand. I just didn't fully see the strengths that I had. I just felt bad about myself. And even after learning some stuff, I remember there was a time in college where, another part of my story, I have depression.
Yeah.
But one of the things that triggered some of it was just not feeling good enough.
Okay.
Like I would see these other people who were so good at public speaking and just working with people, and I loved people. But I just, you know, I have a very small energy tank, and things like even this is just very difficult for me. Yeah. I process things very slowly. I'm a much better writer than speaker, but for some reason there was just this time in college and it was just really getting me down. And I was like, I remember, I think part of it was also because I was training to be a counselor, and I was like, how am I supposed to be a counselor? Like, I'm only going to be able to take on like a couple clients at a time, like, because I love to help people, but I just feel like I can't like think as quickly on the spot. I can't like those other things that you need to be able to help people live,
right?
In person. So I remember, like, I a few times I was just sobbing and like begging God to, it kind of sounds silly, but like I was begging him to change my personality type. Like I was begging, like, could you please help me become more extrovert? Why did you create me this way? I feel like I'm not good at anything. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I just felt like I was not good enough. And what is all these, like these other skills that I have, you know, I have this kind, passionate heart. I want to help people. I feel like I have some good wisdom and, you know, these other things that I was good at, but I felt like, what's the point in having that if I am not good at like speaking to people, or like, I can't, like, how do I then use it? But then it kind of reminded me of Paul when he was talking about the thorn in his flesh.
Yeah.
You know, and he cried out to God like three times, but he didn't take it away.
Right.
And he said, you know, my grace is sufficient for you.
Mm-hmm.
And then that very night, I remember it was like after my third time of asking God to change me pretty much.
Yeah.
Because I wasn't fully understanding my own strengths. Like, that night a friend came into my room and she was needing help. She was needing some advice. And I sat and I listened to her and I was able to help her. And I remember she was leaving and she was so grateful. And afterwards I was alone in my room and I felt this whisper in the back of my mind that was like, see, this is why I created you this way. Not very many other people would have been able to help her in that specific way that you did.
Yeah.
And that, that was just a life-changing moment for me of just realizing like, oh, this is why God created me this way. Like, this is what I can offer to the world and that I have purpose, and that this is, you know, I'm not just all of these weaknesses, that I do actually have strengths that can be used and God will use them.
Yes, absolutely. And I'm sure there are people listening that have felt that resonate really deeply with that. Because I think quite honestly, if everybody listening and myself and Will included, we have all had moments where it's like you see somebody else or you see another gift set or you see whatever it is. And we think, well, why don't I have that?
Yeah.
Or if I could just have those things, then I would be better at this. And we miss something I've learned in my 37 years of life, that we miss so much of what God has for us when we don't want what we have and we want what somebody else has. Mm-hmm. And I think of how many times I've probably missed out on some of what God wanted me to do because I was discontent or thought something was wrong with me. And so I feel like it's just worth sharing again to everybody listening that if you're hearing this, like, there's nothing wrong with you.
Yes.
God doesn't make mistakes. He created you with the exact personality, with the hair, with the body type, with the whatever it is, the way he wanted you to be. Mm-hmm. And it's our world and the things that happen around us that make us think that somehow we are less than, or that we need to shift ourselves to be somebody else's perspective of us. And our only thing we need to do is continue to line ourselves up with who God wants us to be. But that is so hard to do.
So that's why I'm so passionate about this, because I know that there are people out there just like what I experienced who didn't know who they were and didn't see the strengths that they have. Yes. And like, we're all so amazing. Like we all have these different unique strengths and it's beautiful. And it reminds me of like the verses that talk about the body of Christ or like, even if you're not a Christian listening to this, like it's just a really good analogy of how, you know, we've got an arm and that does the things that an arm, like we need an arm, we need an eye, we need two eyes. We need, you know,
you need a big toe. Someone has to be the big toe for balance. And cause
or like a puzzle too. Like we all like the world, we're just all these little puzzle pieces. And when put together, it makes this beautiful picture. And so I want to help people find where they fit. Where they belong in the big picture of things.
I love that, Anna. And that's such a huge thing. So we're going to talk more a little bit about this, but I'm just going to give a plug right now. And I'm not making a plug because Anna's my sister. I would do this with anybody, but Anna is going to talk more about her coaching and read her blog. She's got many blog posts. Go back and look at the YouTube channel videos that just would, I think, give some encouragement. So, Anna, I do feel like we have to say something, and I'm using a word, so nobody get mad at me, and I'm not saying this about my own sister. This is a word she uses about herself, so don't get... the word geek or nerdy a lot. So you do have a lot, because that's why I was like, I'm not calling my sister a geek or a nerd. Like, just let me be clear. You use that word, but I think it's so cool. And I know we have some listeners that for sure have a bent towards that. Why don't you just, why do you label yourself that way? Sometimes I guess I would say, do you want to explain some of why you would say some of your things has a, like a little nerdy bent to it?
So I originally started my blog. It was very broad, just personal development. And as I was learning more about myself and learning what things I could best offer to the world and help people with from my own experiences, along the way, I think it's just been within the past year or two, I just realized that I especially resonate with fellow geeks and creatives because I am one. And so I just, and I had so much fun. I remember I even tried it out one summer just for fun. I had the series called The Geek's Guide to Life. And I was kind of testing out like, oh, is this something that would interest people? And people really loved it.
I think it's great.
And I've always had like lessons from film posts.
Like those are some of my
superheroes and different stuff.
So what would be particular, just so if anybody's listening and just wants further connection, what would be some of your favorite nerdy, like, movie genres or books or what's
The Lord of the Rings is my favorite of all time. I'm a big fan of Doctor Who, Star Wars. Actually wasn't a huge fan of Star Wars until I started watching the animated Clone Wars show.
Because
it just gave so much more background into everything and it made more things make sense. And it's just like a really rich
world, I need to watch the Clone Wars. Will's over behind thumbing up. My family, you also need to know the McConaughey family is huge in Star Wars. And that's where I feel like the oddball out. I do not dislike Star Wars. I am just not as fanatic about it probably as the rest of my family. I try though. It's how I love everybody. I try.
We appreciate it.
Thank you. I can only go so far though. Anyway, okay, so Star Wars, what else? Lord of the Rings.
Oh my goodness. Star Trek, Marvel.
Okay.
DC.
We just watched the Wonder Woman movie too. This is gonna I don't know when this is gonna air yet, but we've been together over Christmas and we didn't even talk about, did you like the movie?
It wasn't as good as I expected, honestly, but I did still enjoy it. I feel like there's so many good elements in it, but just something just felt a bit off for me.
That's valid.
So, but I still enjoyed it. Still,
no one would want my real review because I don't. Wonder Woman is probably one of my favorite. See, I couldn't even tell you. She's DC, right? Not Marvel. See, I'm going to be very quickly out of my. She is probably my favorite superhero, probably across the board. If I had the, especially of the female genre,
I love the first movie much more.
Okay, well then, see, now I'm gonna have to go back.
And I have a blog post about the first movie.
Okay, we can link that. There
you go. You want to learn some lessons from Wonder Woman?
I love it. Okay, Anna. So let's back. Okay, so there's a lot of with personality and different things. So let's back up here. If somebody's just kind of starting off and going, okay, I get this. I do want to know more about myself. I want to learn more about my personality. I want to learn some of these things. Where is a good starting point for anybody to begin? Because there's a bazillion personal development books, and I always prefer people's recommendations because I do think you have to be a little careful with personal development books. You want to make sure you're really, especially if you are a follower of Jesus, just kind of check check yourself along the way to make sure it just all lines up still with scripture. But I think there is very much a place for both things, because I think scripture is actually very clear in a lot of places it talks about. I mean, God did make us uniquely and we want to know. And when we know more about ourselves, it allows us to use the gifts God's given us
exactly.
even more for the world. So if somebody's listening and like, okay, I'm really intrigued, like where would you tell somebody to start with maybe some of the personal growth track development area?
Like a lot, like personality stuff specifically,
well,
or
well, let's talk. Okay, let's
personal
talk about
growth. Follow my blog.
Yeah, follow Anna's blog
and my YouTube channel.
Okay, let's talk about the personality stuff. This is a big, big thing, and if people are really interested in it, listening, we can point out stuff more
so
for you.
I need to give some disclaimers first that with all the personality stuff, these, like, I see people who take it either too seriously or they just don't give it any credit at all.
Yeah.
Like some people, you know, they're like, oh, it's not scientific, so why would you use it? And, but the thing is with anything in the psychology realm with people, like we can only kind of like measure external behaviors. Like we can't read people's minds. We can't, I mean, there's Dr. Dario Nardi actually does some brain scan work that has matched up with the cognitive functions and like Myers-Briggs kind of stuff.
Okay.
That's, it's really interesting. Neuroscience of personality. That might be too
cool
deep to start with, but
for for those of you that are further along, go there. For those of you who are beginners like me, don't lie.
But yeah, so it's, so personality stuff is never going to be completely objective. So, you know, it's not like the end all be all, but it can be a super helpful tool.
Yes.
To just, I mean, we need to be self-aware in order to grow, right?
Absolutely.
Yes. Like you can't fix what you don't understand.
Correct. That's good. That's good.
And both, and just like I said before in the podcast, of understanding your strengths.
Yes.
To be the most amazing version of yourself you can be.
I love it. So if somebody was interested in like the, so there's several, why don't you just real quick touch on, we already said there's like Myers-Briggs. We're going to talk about Enneagram because that is personally one of my very favorite. What are some other personality avenue tools? Are those kind of the two that you would most recommend if somebody was going to go down a road?
Well, the thing with those two, it's just, I mean, people are complex, right?
Yes.
So
I am very complex.
It needs to be kind of a complicated system if you're going to actually explain people very well.
Yeah.
And so it is something that it's,
it takes some time, right? You want to,
yeah,
it should take a little bit of time.
Yes.
One clear, most of what, and I've learned this most with Enneagram in particular, a test isn't necessarily going to give you, you kind of need to learn a lot about all the different things, right? To really
kind of confirm it. Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So
and
why,
to understand it.
Well, why don't you talk? So if somebody, we can put in the show notes, like the Myers-Briggs, because there is a very extensive test for that one, right? That people can do.
Yes, but the thing with tests, like that's what I started off with. I used to recommend this one website to people all the time. But then once I started learning more, I realized how it's just not super reliable because, you know, we can interpret questions differently. And the thing with Myers-Briggs is that it's,
it's okay. It's okay.
I lost my train of thought.
The Myers-Briggs.
Can we pause to
edit
that part out?
Yeah,
and then I can come back.
Yep. You were saying,
I just went completely blank.
It's okay. The Myers-Briggs. You're talking about the test. You're saying that it.
I had a
the
good
thing
thought.
With that. You're saying the test. You used to recommend the one test, but now you don't.
Yes. Oh, okay. So yeah, with Myers-Briggs, it's more about like how your brain processes things, like how it, how you're observing things and how you're making decisions.
Okay.
And so it's kind of hard to know the reason why someone's doing something. So if you answer a question, someone of a different type might answer it the same way,
right?
But you're doing it for a totally different reason.
Yes.
And so that's why if, you know, if you're exploring it yourself and you just kind of want to take the test for fun and then kind of research it later to confirm, then like that can be a good starting place.
Okay.
But I personally recommend, finding someone who does personality profiling sessions, like who does understand it. 'Cause then, they'll ask you questions and then they can ask follow-up questions. So it's like you're getting at, you know, you might be answering the question, but then you can find out, well, why are they doing this? Because that why is what will actually be more of a determining factor of what your type actually is. Does that make sense?
Yes. Hopefully we can't hear your, we'll hear your virtual nodding saying yes. To everybody online. But no, that does make a lot
more
sense.
But I'll give some maybe in the description or the
show notes.
In the show notes. That's what you call it. Yeah. No, I'm a YouTuber, so we call it down in the description below.
It's all right. You can call any one of those things. People will find it.
But I can give some links that do have some good starting places too of explaining, you know, the Myers-Briggs dichotomies, which is again the, you know, the I versus E, the introversion versus extroversion, those kind of the letters. And then also if you want to go super deep into the cognitive functions.
Okay. See, you lost me at cognitive functions. I don't even know what that means. But okay, so let me ask you this, Anna, and then I want to talk about the Enneagram for a minute. So if somebody's listening and like, okay, I feel like there's two tracks of people when you bring up personality tests real. Because there are the people that are like, oh, I love it. I'm kind of intrigued. Well, there's lots of different people. But the people that are, I'm kind of intrigued by it, but I don't know where to start. And then there's the people that are like, I don't need anybody to tell me I'm too complex. Yes. They're not right anyway. Which I would say sometimes when I've done some, I'm like, this does not explain me enough to know. Mm. Will's giving me weird looks over your shoulder. He said, like, don't put me in a little box. Like, I am too complex. Like, this is not accurate. So what would you tell people about all of
that? It's not to put you in a box. It's just to help, you know, with all of this, it's kind of more of the general patterns that we see with people.
Yes.
And, you know, actually, I just did my first YouTube guest appearance on Joyce's channel. She has, we can include that down below too. She has a series called Type Talks, and she interviews different people of different personality types. But she had 9 INFJs come on of each different Enneagram type. And so there's things like that can, like, we're able to compare and contrast, like, okay, we're all INFJs, but we're kind of like a different flavor of INFJ based on our different Enneagram type. And so there's different things like that can affect it as well. Okay. So it's not like, oh, you are only like 1 in 16, you know.
Yes. I think that's where it tricks people. Like, right? Like, I am this thing and I have to act this way, or like, kind of what you're talking about with the introvert versus extrovert is like, hey, no, they can still be a lot of different colors of the rainbow in every thing. But
it's not meant to limit you. It's just to help understand more about yourself. And it's like, then you can determine, where am I on this growth path? So, you know, there's certain things that you might have in common that it gives you a good starting place of like, where do I even start in trying to learn to grow? It helps you develop that self-awareness.
I think that's great. Well, we'll make sure to link all of that below. Just real quick, because Enneagram is a beast of its own too. What is the Enneagram, and how is that maybe a little different than some of the other personality test out there? Or
So I will give a little disclaimer again, to maybe take what I say about the Enneagram with a grain of salt, because I am still new to that. I know a lot more about the Myers-Briggs kinds of systems than Enneagram. But from my understanding, the Enneagram is more about inner motivations and how you see the world and your fears and different coping mechanisms that you have.
Okay. Yeah.
And defense mechanisms as well.
I love it. Enneagram has been one of my favorite tools thus far, and I feel like has been the most eye-opening to me about just all of that. Like, the other ones have been great and I've learned a lot, but for some reason that one just resonated more deeply with me and has been very helpful.
We joke in the type community about, because like, I'm on Twitter and so there's just a whole bunch of us that are into personality type that have all found each other.
Okay.
And we kind of joke about how, you know, Myers-Briggs, like, it shows you your strengths and weaknesses, but then Enneagram is just like, here's how you're awful.
It does kind of, because like when they give you the names, like the title, there's like a title for each number.
Mm-hmm.
They're kind of like, you are a little bit offended where you're like, that's, hold on.
Because
like,
this one is even more so specifically for personal development, I think. So it's showing you, like, here's where you're kind of struggling.
Yes.
Here's where you've built up defense mechanisms in this specific way. So that then you can, I think they call it integration.
Right.
In Enneagram. Like, so you can become more whole and more balanced and just the it's best version
fun.
Of yourself.
It's been a fun thing. I like to ask people about their Enneagram type. So if you are listening and you know Enneagram types, feel free to comment on one of our posts. I personally would love to hear what number or wings or all the things. You can go very, very deep in all of it. But
should we share our types?
Sure. Anna, what are you? What
Enneagram? I think, did we end up being the same?
I think so, but you know you different more subtypes, than probably. I do. Yeah, and I know some. I haven't dug super, super deep.
And that might be an interesting conversation, too, of how it how it has like a different flavor based on our different other personality types.
I think if people met us or knew us, they probably wouldn't think we were the same personality, like the same personality type. But the Enneagram is a little different, and we actually are the same Enneagram number. So
I am an Enneagram 1, which it can be nicknamed the reformer or the perfectionist.
I prefer the reformer than the perfectionist, but that's okay. Maybe that's my perfectionism coming out. Don't call me a perfectionist. Don't label me that. Like, now I have to live up to some standard. Reformer sounds cooler.
Yeah. And that's something that I found interesting. I think that's why I actually thought I was a 2 at first before I actually looked into it. Like when I took online tests and just read descriptions, I was like, oh, I'm a 2.
Yeah.
I like helping people. Like that's my main motivation. But then whenever I explored it more, I realized, I'm a 1. That's my main motivation is to do a good job and to better my whole blog here. Can you tell?
Yes. Like
I'm all about personal development.
Yes. Type 1s are, the reformer really is the better. It can sometimes come out like in that perfectionist thing. Mine comes out a little differently, I feel like. But it is that just a strong sense of right and wrong. There's fairness to be good, that the world is good and people can be good. And so there's kind of all of that bent roped in there.
Yeah. And I think I also didn't originally think I was a 1 because a lot of the descriptions sounded more like, sensors, like in the Myers-Briggs system, you know, the S.
Yes.
Like, and I'm pretty sure I'm still figuring out your type. I'm going to have you
that test
do a session with you sometime. Yeah. But
I'm a rare breed. What can I say?
So like that, I think that's one of our differences of like, you like to keep your home very beautiful and clean.
I'm very orderly.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And I'm not that as much because I'm an INFJ. So I'm not as, I don't particularly pay attention to my environment as much. Like it might bother me if someone comes over and my place is a mess, but I'm more, I don't know. I'm more of a perfectionist in like the words that I'm saying when I'm writing. I'm a very good editor.
Yeah. No, and that's good because they are very, because a lot of times people would see the ones, that would be those misconceptions with personality types is that it is like nothing can be out of place. Nothing can, and it, like you just said, it's very different for us how it, but even with mine, I do very much create, like, I just like cleanliness and order and all of that kind of stuff. But it's not, I am not as perfectionist in like what I'm, at a certain point I can just be like, this is going to have to be good enough. Like I got to get past this and I can't do it anymore.
I'm embarrassed to admit, but I might take like 30 minutes to send a text message.
That's all right. See, that's how it just does all a little different. So you should be freed up. Really what I think we're saying is like the personality, to any of those avenues or tools, like Anna said, they really should be freeing you up to learn more about how God uniquely wired and created you. They shouldn't feel like it's this box or confining, and they should help you be able to learn and grow and explore more about who you are.
Exactly.
So I love it. Okay, Anna, let's talk about, so it's a new year. A new year is coming. Probably by the time people are listening to this, we will already be in 2021. And I know you're big on goals, intentions, what would be the word? Everybody kind of right now uses a different, it used to be like New Year's resolutions. Resolutions have kind of taken on like a little bit of a bad word. Like people don't make the, you know, whatever, you know, whatever you want to call it. So what's your kind of word for, do you set goals? Do you have intentions?
Yeah.
Do you make resolutions?
So I do very much believe in SMART goals, you know, specific, measurable, whatever the other ones are.
Yes.
But I do like, I think like 5 or 6 years ago, I started that tradition of choosing a one word or phrase to kind of be my theme for the year.
Yep.
And I kind of like to think of it as like each year of your life is either like a different volume, like a book volume or maybe a different chapter. And so it's like, what would be like the title of that section of your life or this theme that you're aiming for, or, you know, maybe there's something that you're wanting to give more attention to, like something that you know that like in this year I'm going to be working on these things or these goals. And so I need this reminder for myself, or maybe this covers like some of the goals that I'm working on.
Yes.
So the ones that I've chosen for this year is make mistakes.
Make mistakes. I like
because
it.
Because I've been still very much struggling with my perfectionism. You know, okay. We just talked about the Enneagram 1.
Yes.
Ooh, and so someone else I recommend for the Enneagram is Beatrice Chestnut. Okay. She has some really good content. And I've just started kind of exploring her, but she talks about how, you know, all the other Enneagram types, like these are the different areas where you can grow and improve.
Yeah.
But she says Enneagram 1 is different in that we need to get worse to get better.
I would believe that.
Because we're already the perfectionist, right? We're so focused on trying to better ourselves to a fault.
To not fail.
Yes.
Yes.
And so she talks about getting worse to get better. And
I love
so,
that.
Oh my gosh, it hurts even just to talk about this right now. But yeah, so I've made it make mistakes. So I have my old planner in front of me right now, but I just bought a new planner for 2021. It has some bullet pages in the back where I I make my goals and everything. But I made a page where I'm going to start listing all of my mistakes.
I think that's
which
good.
Usually would be a bad thing, right? Pointing out your own mistakes.
Yeah.
But the thing that I'm trying to do is work on my self-talk to become more aware, you know, taking every thought captive kind of thing of whenever I make a mistake, instead of beating myself up about it, because I have a very harsh inner critic, I'm going to celebrate it.
Yeah.
Because if I'm making mistakes, it means that I'm actually doing things. I'm taking action. I'm taking risks. I'm facing my fears, and learning and growing. So
yeah.
Trying to shift my mindset to that.
I love it. I think there's some of you listening that maybe that needs to be your phrase too. But okay, let's talk about this because so some people listening might be well-versed in like, yes, I have a word or a theme. I do that every year. Some people might be like, I don't really know what you're talking about. I've never done this before. Like, how would you suggest to somebody brand new starting maybe in like, you know what? I kind of like this idea. I would kind of love to have a focus or a theme for the year. How does one find or figure out what that is?
Yeah. To plug myself again, I do have a blog post that goes even more into detail about it. And I have a free worksheet if you sign up to my mailing list
at
therealanna.com. So I talk about it a lot more there, but I kind of go about it by reflecting on my previous year, you know, what worked well, what didn't, you know, this past year was especially crazy.
Yes. Yeah.
So I don't know, maybe you need like grace or something like, yeah. I don't know what you're dealing with, but yeah. And then to think on like, what would I like to be in 2022? Like what is my aim? Kind of thinking farther ahead.
Yeah.
What's that quote by Viktor Frankl? I have it in the blog post. It's a really good quote that inspired one of my questions, that I kind of just said it just now, but thinking about how does he word it? I word it so much better in my blog post.
It's all right.
But so you can check that out. But yeah, it's just thinking ahead of like, what things would I regret not doing this? Like if I'm in 2022, what things would I regret having not done? And then you just do it instead.
Yeah, that's great. I think everybody, because I think we all to a point live like you just don't know. And it's kind of like, hey, if I had the ability to zoom a year ahead and go, hey, what would I do differently? And the great thing is you really can on some level, because we can look back now on 2020. And again, even though 2020 had a lot of very unforeseeable things happen, we still are in control of our perspective on it, how we respond to it.
Yeah.
And so going like, what's the person I want to continue to be? And what are the things that are going to help serve me to be able to be that person?
Yeah. And so it can be some kind of attribute or affirmation for yourself. Or, you know, there's quite a few different ways you can go about it.
I love it. Well,
but may I say one thing? It's a little bit off topic, but wanted to say it for those listening because, you know, 2020 has been a hard year.
Yes.
And especially for me, as I've still been working on my perfectionism and like having to remind myself, like, I can't live by what my circumstances used to be. Like we have to doing your best involves doing your best with the time you have, with the resources you have, with the energy you have, and like taking in consideration your circumstances.
That's
and
good.
I sometimes forget that a lot.
Yeah.
And so I just wanted to encourage everyone out there as you're setting goals for this next year, remember that they're not supposed to be like, you know, I think of like deadlines. It has dead in it. Like they're supposed to be like your lifelines. It's supposed to, it's for you. And so if it's no longer serving you, you can change your goals later. You can, I just want everyone to enter this year giving yourself grace.
It's good.
And not beating yourself up if unexpected things happen. You know, we're still in a pandemic right now at the time we're recording this and probably will be for a while.
Probably will be,
So there's just a lot of unexpected things happening right now. And so just remember to give yourself grace. Remember that you can shift your goals.
Yes.
Because they're meant to be for you.
Yeah. Let's talk about that for a second, because I think that's what happens is so often there's probably people listening or that are like, okay, I used to set goals, but this year after year, I never accomplished them. And so getting to the beginning of a new year actually feels like a slap in the face. And it feels sad because it's just a reminder of all the things I didn't do that I wanted to do. And I've talked to quite a few people like that. It's like, well, I don't make goals, you know, and it really does kind of make me sad because again, they shouldn't be, like you said, they shouldn't feel like these deadlines or like, hey, the beauty is they're the goals you're making. You can change, you're in control of them. So can you, because I think that does trip quite a few people up. And we had some friends on earlier this year, Matt Granados, he is Life Pulse Inc. They have this whole planner that's about goal setting and just all, it's so huge and about focus. If you missed that episode, I would highly encourage you to go back and listen to Matt talk about it too, because it was just really just another good perspective on setting goals and what that looks like. Because we talked a lot about like, hey, we were towards the end of this year and a lot of people probably gave up on their goals or they got slowed down. And it's like, hey, that's okay. Like,
yeah,
let's move on. But what advice would you give to people as they're trying to set goals that are maybe manageable? Because someone like our personality type might also be like, I'm going to write the the Pulitzer Prize novel this year or whatever, you know, like this. And it's like, okay, well, those are great. And maybe for some people that is a realistic goal or dream. And I'm not saying don't do that, but how do we maybe actually find goals that are more on brand and on pace for where we're at?
Well, I will plug myself again. I have a YouTube video called How to Set Goals During Uncertain Times.
That's good.
I give a lot more there if you're wanting to learn even more, but first of all, like again, just to give yourself grace and know that things might shift and to become more comfortable with that. I mean, that's why I've made my theme for this year, make mistakes, because like to try to get out of that mindset of like, if I don't reach this goal, I've failed. And that's not the case. You're learning more about yourself. You're learning what doesn't work. Like even if that's all that happened this year, like you learned what didn't work for you, that's still beneficial.
Right.
And again, to remember that each of us are different. Like that's part of why I wanted to start my blog, was because there's so much advice out there that is very cookie cutter, but like we are not cookie cutter people. And I think it's because they just might not fully understand themselves, like how people are different. Cause they're just like, oh, this worked for me. So this must be what works.
Right.
And so they kind of like preach that of like, this is the only way to do this. And so I just wanted to remind everybody again that if you're trying to follow the advice of, you know, some self-help guru or like even your friends and it's not working for you, that there's not something wrong with you. It's very likely that you're just a different personality type.
Yeah.
And so again, like it comes back around to like the more you learn about yourself, you'll be able to learn what works for you. Because again, what works for Sarah might not work for me and vice versa. And so we can't be trying to...
No, that's good. Something I found, and Will and I, so I don't know when this is going to air, so there might be cross information. So Will and I are going to do an episode talking about just kind of our process individually and together, how we kind of look back and whatever. But one thing I've really learned that's helped me over the last few years is to not go like, I want to lose 15 pounds, like, or I want to like to actually for me, because I'm such a perfectionist or whatever, and I will hold so highly to the written thing I put out is to actually help myself by giving myself grace and even how I word the goal to say, hey, I want to be healthier. And today that looks like X, Y, and Z, not a certain concrete end goal. And realizing that often we sometimes limit ourselves by that because where you could go further, the weight one is not always a great one because it really should just be, I want to be healthier anyway, or I want to start a blog, or this year we started a podcast. Actually in 2020, that was not a goal at the beginning. that we knew we wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And so it's not like, hey, we have some goals for it, but it wasn't like, we want to have a million. It was like, hey, we want to tell good stories and we want to do this and we want to tell these many things that just kind of leave it open-ended, but still has a goal that is still quantifiable a little bit, but not so concrete.
Yeah. And I think bringing it back again to that's where it's good to know yourself because at times, like in my life, it was very good to follow that advice of, you know, having very specific, measurable goals and, and having deadlines and having very specific numbers. And so that might still be what you need.
Yeah.
But, you know, right now I'm in a season, and actually for the past few years, because I was in 2018, I was dealing with health issues and then like some depression stuff. And it was just really throwing me off because I had everything like, I knew myself well. I knew like when my most productive hours of the day, I had it all set, and then everything changed. And now it seems like every day it's just unpredictable. And so I don't, it's just harder for me right now in this season, and probably for a lot of people because you know, 2020, to know what I'm actually, it's just hard to set realistic goals because everything is just so unpredictable right now.
I want to travel 5 times. Well, we don't know.
You're like,
So I think that's great. I love the advice on this, the goals, finding things that work for you. And again, just like everything, your goals and my goals might look very different and that's okay.
Yes,
like they need to be for you. Mm-hmm. I love it. Okay, Anna, I want to just real quick, because I've got several things I want to touch on, and the time always goes way too fast on our show. Talk to me. You just recently started a coaching program.
Yes.
Can you just tell a little bit about what that is? And if somebody is wanting to know more, just like, hey, I need some help.
Yeah.
What is your new service kind of providing?
Yeah. So I just launched a coaching business called the Pen Pal Coach. And it's called the Pen Pal Coach because I actually do coaching through email. And I also send them special goodies in the mail, little
Who
surprises.
Doesn't love goodies?
Yeah. And so it's especially for, you know, it's introvert friendly or busy life friendly, you know, cause you know, you don't have to set a specific appointment. You can just email me whenever and you have unlimited access to me. So yeah, it just fits in with your schedule. You know, if you are an introvert and you're trying to go after your dreams and maybe you're, you know, going on more podcasts or like doing things that are draining you. I just didn't want to be another thing to drain people. I wanted to just be a benefit to them as they're working towards their goals. So yeah, that's my main focus, is helping people with their goals. And of course, like with everything I do, you know, I throw in some personality and self-awareness kind of work in that, because again, like I think that's the key, knowing yourself to be able to grow and reach your goals. I throw in some geeky elements. Like you can tell right away if you go to my website, it just kind of has like a bit of a fantasy kind of theme.
It looks cool.
I gamified it a bit. So you get, stickers mailed to you that you can unlock achievements. So when you accomplished certain milestones or certain tasks that we work on together, you can get those stickers that are exclusive.
Nice.
And I always start everyone off with, I wrote this ebook. That's just a very good starting place to kind of cover some basic personality things. I actually go over Gretchen Rubin's The Four Tendencies.
Okay.
Either you can go search that, or I don't know if we'll have time to talk about that later, but because I think it's a very helpful tool. That's a simple one to get started, but it's very specifically helps you when you're trying to work towards your goals. And I just cover other things, and then it becomes more personalized as we go on, because again, everybody's different. And so I will help you kind of figure out what works for you and what doesn't.
That's perfect. Well, if you're looking for some extra help, check out Pen Pal Coach, and maybe Anna will be able to assist you.
Yeah, I have some different packages. That's like, I think 3, 6, and 12 months. And then I also have a starter pack where you get the ebook and just 1 week of coaching with me to kind of jumpstart.
Awesome.
So depending on your budget, or if you just want to kind of DIY it yourself, but you're just wanting some help getting started, I have that available as well.
That's awesome. I think a lot of people could benefit from, sometimes like you said, sometimes you just need a little outside perspective too, and just somebody to listen and go, hey, how about, have you tried these things? Or here's the thing. So coaching is such a great thing and can be very beneficial.
Yeah,
so,
and I've personally benefited from that from others as well.
That's awesome. That's very cool. Okay, Anna, is there anything we didn't cover that you want to talk about or touch on that we didn't get today?
I guess I could just real quick. We've thrown a lot at you.
A lot of terms. You're like, what am
You know, since it is the beginning of the year, I do highly recommend Gretchen Rubin. She's she's just a very well-known, she's a best-selling author and just in the personal development niche. And she's done research on, just like, why do some people struggle with their goals and other people don't?
Okay.
And like how, like, you know, that kind of stuff. And so she's developed these four tendencies that, it kind of explains like how readily you meet inner versus outer expectations.
Okay.
So there's four of them. And, I think it's super helpful because, you know, accountability is something that's often said as like, everybody needs accountability, but there's actually one type called the rebel, this tendency that actually accountability has kind of the opposite effect on them because they struggle to meet inner and outer expectations.
Okay.
I think like the phrase she gives with them is like, you can't make me and neither can I. I don't know if you've met someone that or if you are someone like that out there. And so it's just a very helpful tool in kind of seeing like, oh, how, like, for example, I thought I was the upholder, which is good at meeting outer and inner expectations.
Okay.
But because like I was valedictorian at school but then I realized afterwards when I started not having that outside accountability that I really struggled.
Okay.
And so I realized that I'm actually the type called the obliger because there's the upholder that easily meets inner and outer expectations.
Okay.
And then the opposite is the rebel. And then on either side, you have the questioner who more easily meets their own expectations and struggles with others' expectations on them, unless if it, you know, lines up with their own inner expectations.
Okay.
And then the opposite of that is the obliger, which is, you know, it's kind of reminds me of the Enneagram too, with the obliger of like, easily meets other people's, they just more easily can serve other people and do things like that, but they struggle with their own goals.
Okay.
And so I realized that I was actually that because I was struggling when I didn't have that outside accountability. And so that's something that I learned for myself that having some kind of outside source, like even if it's like kind of made up, like having a planner and my task list or knowing that like, oh, my followers know that I post on these days or, you know, that kind of external accountability is helpful for me. But, you know, that's it just, again, different people work different ways. And so I think that's just a very helpful tool for people wanting to work towards their goals and get some help with that.
Yeah, that sounds great. Cause that does, like you said, just knowing yourself and how all of those things can best serve you is huge. So maybe one of your goals this year needs just to be, I need to learn a little more about myself and I need to do a little more self-discovery and find some things out so you know
and
better for the rest
of you. I say maybe don't go for all of these all at once. Maybe
don't do it.
We've thrown a lot out at you and I just, you know, I wanted to give you some options, you know, so maybe one of these sounded more interesting to you or like, hey, that might help me with what I'm working on right now.
That would be my personality type. Be like, I'm going to do all five of these things right now. I'm going to figure it out and I'm going to be the best at whatever it can be. Don't do that.
One step at a time.
Set yourself up for failure. That's what would happen. Pick one, figure it out. And Anna, where can people follow you, find you if they want to ask more questions? What's the best?
Yeah. So my main website is therealanna.com and it's spelled like my last name, R-E-E-L. And then just almost all over social media anywhere. I'm most active on Twitter, but I'm everywhere at therealanna. And then you can get to my coaching through my website. So if you remember one thing, therealanna.com, you can find everything there, but I do have a website separate. That's penpalcoach, .com for my coaching.
Awesome. And we'll link all that in the show notes too. So you guys can easily find it. Okay, Anna. So this has been very fun.
Yeah.
This wasn't too painful, was it?
No.
Okay, good. Do you have any, I feel like I need to add, cause you're actually, Elena, I think said this when you came in.
What?
You're our first family member who is not like currently does not live inside the walls of my own house that has been on the podcast. So that's exciting. Do you have any like, be nice, but do you have any stories or anything you want to share about growing up with me as your sister? We have a little, it's a little weird for it because I'm actually almost 11 years older than you.
Yes.
So we
so
actually,
you were out of the house by the time I was like,
yeah, what? You were like 10 or 11 and when I got married. So we didn't get to spend a lot of your, like the early growing up years together. But do you have anything you want to share about being my sister?
I might be a little biased, but I remember when I was a kid, I just always thought you were the most beautiful woman and the most beautiful singer. And I always wanted to be just like you.
Well, that is very, I did not pay her to say that. That's not what I expected her to say. That is very kind.
I really did. I just always looked up to you.
Well, thank you, Anna. I thought it was the coolest thing. I have a younger brother. So we have a brother, Nathan, and he's 2.5 years younger than I am. And I loved having him but I always wanted a baby sister. So I remember when my parents told me, I was convinced from day one that I was getting a sister. So good thing that you were a sister. I probably would have been very disappointed, but wanted a sister. And one of my favorite memories is Anna would always, you would dress up in all these different costumes and different things. And one year for my birthday, I had friends over and you were like the birthday fairy. Yes. It was like one of my favorite, you had all these little things set up.
That.
You had your look. That's one of my favorite things. So
I like doing birthdays. Apparently I was, cause I remember also like either for your 15th or 16th birthday, like I guess I was like 5 or 6 and I planned all these things for you. I made a pinata out of paper cause I like doing crafty things. And
maybe it's part of a one person. We like parties. It's when we're healthy. We go to Enneagram 7, which are like the party
there
people.
We go.
Cause I do like a good party. It's fun. Okay, Anna, one last question. So the podcast is called Now That's Something Good. So do you have anything good that you want to share with us?
I do. I actually found a quote that I really liked that I wanted to share, I think is something good. So it's a quote from Anne Frank, and it says, "Everyone has inside of him a piece of good news. The good news is that you don't know how great you can be, how much you can love, what you can accomplish, and what your potential is."
I love that. I feel like that needs to be a new part of our podcast.
Yeah,
like
I thought that was good because the good news and good related news, back good to stories. Personality too of like,
I love
it. The goals.
That's definitely something good.
Nailed it.
Loved it. Awesome. See, that wasn't a mistake. You have to try again on another. That was a good one. Awesome. Thanks, Anna, for being here.
Thank you.
Wow, I really enjoyed my conversation with Anna, and I hope you did too. So many great little nuggets of just wisdom and truth in there, and I hope that you will lean into what she shared. And this next year, really take some time to hopefully know yourself a little bit better so that you can continue to grow in the path that God has for you. Like I said, we're excited to be bringing you all these shows back. If you need any links or resources, make sure to check out our show notes. All of the things that Anna and I discussed today will be there, so you can find all of them, including her YouTube channel, the blog post, all of those fun things. Make sure to check out the show notes to find those. We'll be right back next week, next Wednesday, with a brand new podcast episode. Will and I are going to be sharing some stories from our vacation and some ways that we kind of look at a year behind us and a year in front of us. So make sure not to miss an episode. Make sure you're subscribed so you never miss one. And if you wouldn't mind, we would love for you to rate and share Now That's Something Good. If you've already done that, thank you so much. If you haven't yet, if you would take just a moment wherever you podcast and make sure you're subscribed and just either give us 5-star review would be amazing, or you can just hit the little stars or share something about the podcast so others can find it. That's huge. It helps us just be able to continue to share stories and makes our podcast just a little bit more visible to other people so that they can find the stories too. And if this conversation was a blessing to you, maybe you'll take a moment and share it with a friend or two who could really hear and love to hear this as well. Anyway, friends, I'm glad you're back with us. We're glad to be back, and we'll see you back next week on Wednesday with Now That's Something Good.